Well, good morning. I'm Spence Hawley, the minority leader for the House, and with us this morning we have Senator Troy Hinert is the assistant minority leader for the Senate. As we start off our first press conference for the year, we're going to try to focus on the Medicaid expansion discussion and with opening comments, and then we'll throw it out for if there's any questions. Obviously, the big discussions, as we've said this year, are the Medicaid expansion, the education, changing the funding formula and adding more money into the formula, and then from a Democrat side, we really want to get into the good government discussions and different areas of that. The Medicaid expansion, we have been pushing from our caucus for the last 3 years, as you know. We've had several bills on. We just think that it's so important for the people in South Dakota that we do get this out there. The 50,000 people that the governor's using for the number now that this could benefit in giving health care to is just extremely important for South Dakota. The other function of the Medicaid expansion that's so important is the Native American population, and I'm going to let Senator Hinert go on that in a moment, a little bit more detail, but what this does for the Native American, especially on the proposal with IHS for the 100% reimbursement, will totally change the landscape on Indian health care. So that's another product. One of the things we've seen in the news recently is talking about expanding welfare and putting more people in the welfare roles and taking them out of work and encouraging people not to work. But first off, to qualify for the Medicaid expansion, it goes up to 138%. On a single person, that's just a little bit over $16,000 a year income. Not an incentive to quit work to get on expansion. You know, 60%, and this put out by the governor's office, 60% of the people in the expansion are working. What we're really talking about is the working poor discussion here. It's the person you go talk to at the convenience store. It's a person that you stop when you go get your groceries and they're working at the checkout line. That's the person who can't afford to buy health care. And I would say many of them are probably working longer hours than most of us. So it's not an encouragement at all. With the 100%, I should go back. The last 3 years we've been discussing, and the numbers always comes out, $35-36 million is going to be the state's cost. And that, again, came from the governor originally 3 years ago. So we've talked that it's going to be a $36 million cost to expand. Since that time, the governor's gone back, and they have redone the numbers, the number of eligibles. They've put in some extra buffer for the number of eligibles. They put in an extra buffer for the number of people that they think will be coming on immediately, and they put in an extra buffer that the cost of it's going to go up. So they talk in terms of the $55 million. So it's $20 million more than our discussion last year. So the $55 million is an ultra conservative number for the cost of expansion. And we're good with that. But what makes it possible now with the IHS expansion to 100% of reimbursement for dual eligibles, Native Americans that are tribe members and on Medicaid receiving services off the reservation, that $67 million that creates in that new reimbursement rate more than covers the $55 million cost that the governor's talking about. So not only does it more than cover it, under the ultra-conservative, it brings in a net income to the state of South Dakota. And I would argue it's going to be more than the $17 million that they're talking about over time. The other thing we look at, for example, I visit with my county commissioners, the indigent care cost to the counties. Brookings County the last 3 years has spent about $170,000 on indigent care. I got an email from a Clay County commissioner. Their costs the last 3 years were $165,000 for indigent care. Now, if you start adding that up on every county in the state, it becomes a significant number of what we're going to save just at the county level. And I don't even know what the charity care at the hospitals, how much that they're paying for emergency care that they don't ever get reimbursed for, or how much of it's been transferred over to us on the commercial health insurance market on the shift of cost. The number can't be put on that. One of the numbers, and if you look at the governor's numbers, if we do the expansion this year, over the next 5 years, it will bring in just over $2.35 billion into our healthcare system in South Dakota. Now, a billion gets thrown around a lot at the national level, but if you throw $2.35 billion into South Dakota's economy and into our healthcare system, there is no doubt in my mind that it's going to raise the water for everybody. We have to see increased care, not only for the people who expand to Medicaid, but just throughout the system in general. Expanding for the 138% of the federal poverty level, on an individual, you're talking $16,243. On a family of four, you're talking an income of $33,000, $33,465. If you use those numbers, those people don't have extra money left over to buy health insurance with, and that's the market we're talking about. But I'm going to turn it over to Senator Heinert now, and he has a lot more specifics on IHS side of it.
Well, good morning. I'm Senator Troy Heinert from District 26, and I'm a member of the Rosebud Sioux Tribe. When I was on the Healthcare Coalition's task force, and part of the conversation really started with the lack of access to care and the quality of care we're receiving at IHS right now. When we started looking at this, we got together with providers, with HHS and CMS, and say, how do we transform what is happening at IHS? Because if you are Medicaid eligible right now and you go to an IHS facility, that is 100% federal Medicaid dollar. There's no IHS dollar, there's no state dollar. As soon as you leave that IHS facility, that becomes the half federal, half state dollar. That IHS dollar is already small. It's critically underfunded. So we were supplementing our hospital with Medicaid dollars. And that's the only thing that kept our hospital going. With this new plan, with the new FMAP rate, with the new contracting authority that IHS would now have, if we can get this passed, we can then work with providers, provide the e-emergency, provide the telehealth, the third-party billing, do the things, have access to the things that other hospitals do and we don't have right now. We've recently had our emergency room closed at Rosebud, and if you are picked up in an ambulance, you are going to another town, oftentimes with no ride home, and nobody knows who's going to pay the bill. And we can't allow that to happen in our state. So I've really been working that side of Medicaid expansion, just the changes to the IHS system. I've never seen IHS have movement like they have in the last 3 or 4 months. So I'm really looking forward to keeping this conversation going. I've been telling my fellow legislators, there's about 10% of our population are Native Americans. That's roughly 80, 85,000 people. With one vote, you can change healthcare for 85,000 people, and you cannot do that. I've never seen that done in my time up here, and I can't think of a more important vote that you'll have to take.
Just as a little bit more information item, two nights ago, we had the governor had a reception. We've got a team of 10 in from DC, from IHS services, CMS, and U.S. Department of Health and Human Services came in. And their intent, what they're out here for, is they're meeting with the staffs from Department of Social Services, Department of Health, the governor's staff, and drafting, first off, the rules to finalize the rules that they hopefully will be sending out in a couple weeks and how they would infect us. And second, they're helping South Dakota out what would we do in our plan to meet the rule requirement. And they've been working back and forth with the South Dakota staff and the Washington people to come up with a plan, hopefully that's going to be acceptable to work. There's a couple issues out there that they're working, and the comment was is that within a couple weeks we should know where we're going to be at. And as the governor's explained this already, you know, as soon as they get the official rule back from the Washington, D.C., then our Department of Social Services will take and put a pen to each of those items and how we can change, and hopefully it comes up to the $55 million in savings through the 100% reimbursement. And so everything's kind of boiling underneath right now and all these discussions, and everybody's posturing. I am for it, I'm against it, whatever, but really there's no discussion that's going to happen for another 2 or 3 weeks until we get that back. And the governor said repeatedly that if it doesn't show that it pays for himself, he's not going to support it anymore. I'm really optimistic that from everything I keep hearing, that I think this is going to happen. I think the cost is going to be there to pay for it. Even if it wasn't there, I would still be in a position that this is the right thing to do no matter what. But hopefully we don't have to go to that discussion on it. We're going to open it up, unless you have any other comments.
No, I'm take some questions.
We'll open it up for any questions, any other issues that you want to address.
Can you two speak to a Republican bill that would require drug testing for welfare recipients?
You know, we've had this bill 3-4 times out here before. And when we've, my first 2 years I was on the health committee, and we had these two bills come through up there, and the department back then came and testified that it's not an issue. The people that are receiving the program right now are the mothers with children, primarily, and the disabled, and that drug abuse is not an issue on there. And the cost to put that program in would be so prohibitive that they said we should not go there. That being said, I do have a problem pulling that segment of the public out and saying you need to be drug tested. And because you don't make enough money, you must be on drugs is a big leap for me, and I just can't take that. Is there an issue? There might be a minor issue. But again, it's the 60% people working already on it, I would say that's taking care of itself.
I would agree with what Representative Hawley has to say, but I think it's to me that it's kind of poor shaming. Because you're poor that you've made bad life choices, and that your life choices include drug use. You know, the cost to the state, other states have passed this, went back and looked and said, you know, this has cost us way more than it ever saved. And it doesn't get to the issue. Of course, we don't want illegal drug use either, but, you know, making them take a test because they're on welfare does not get to the issue of stopping drug use. So, you know, if you are really concerned about people using drugs, then let's have that conversation. And it should be fair. Anybody who takes state money, you can't just single out one class. You know, I'd be willing to take the test. You know, farmers who receive subsidies, you know, anybody who works in state government, you know, we all take state money.
You know, an interesting side note on the discussion of Medicaid expansion, one of the items that the department is looking at is that when we expand, we will also be picking up addiction treatment cost and behavioral cost for behavioral treatment. So rather than talking about and pointing a finger at somebody said you should not qualify, we would take the other route under it and help them to get out of this problem and solve the issue. And I think that is a better approach, and I hope we continue down that road on that approach. Any other questions?
What do you two make of the governor's poll on teacher pay?
I'm sorry, I missed the last word there. You want to make a comment first?
Well, I saw the poll as well. You know, our stance is it's not going far enough, And I think his poll would say the same thing if he used our numbers. So I think, you know, the people of South Dakota expect us to do something, and we should do something, but we should do it right. And in order to do it right, we're going to need more money. And we know it's a tough sell. It's a tough sell at a half a penny. It's a tough sell at a penny. But if the penny gets us there, let's go do it.
Yeah, and I would agree. I think that what the governor's poll, I would say it's a conservative poll on the other side from just the discussions. I come from Brookings. Brookings I would consider very education-oriented. And to a person that talks to me, the question is get it done. And from our proposal to increase to the 50,000 on raising it from the 48.5 of the governor's proposal on average teacher level, and our proposal to keep the same number of teachers that we have now in our student teacher ratio, we a lot of support for that. And the governor talks the 0.5%, we talk in terms that we should do the 0.5%, and because we aren't going to have this discussion for another decade if we do something this year. And I just hear a lot of support for that. So we're supportive of what the governor's done on the education. We haven't got into the major. The bills haven't been dropped yet. It's just a discussion item at the moment. But we would hope to take it to the next step and expand the discussion and solve the problem, period. And then let's move on to some other issues next year for a change. Good to go. Is there any online questions? Okay. Well, this would be a good, easy start for the beginning of the year. Thanks for your time. We appreciate it. There's going to be other issues that are starting to pop up that we can address. A lot of them are rumors right now, and they're starting to show up in committees. So we'll see how it goes. Thank you.
Well, I thank you as well. You know, healthcare is of utmost importance. And I encourage the people watching, get a hold of your legislator and ask them to support this, because it's now's the time. And I'd also like to say happy 21st birthday, Jordan. That's my daughter.